on your own with not no reference to API 610 or AS 1210 is the other one we have, and also a German standard. You will still have to define A, B, and C, but you can then put any numbers here if you want, once you define that performance system. It's pretty convenient, once you understand it. The one complication for this is when you have an end suction pump. All right, this arrow here is showing that defect. Now, this is a pump, and the pump, this is an end suction pump. So the shaft is in this direction, in the X direction. The motor's back here, so the shaft is in the X direction. But here's the end suction. Well, this is the A axis, and I'm trying to probe the B axis as well. The probe doesn't want to do that. So just as a general rule, if you are doing an end suction pump, specify the B axis and the Y vector. If you run into this problem, remember what I just said and you'll be able to figure it out. Or ask support. Okay. Anybody use the flange checks in Caesar 2? Why do you do everything in this? Okay. The flange check is a very conservative approach. You convert the bending moment and the axial load on a flange pair into an equivalent pressure. It's a common calculation. It's been used for a very long time. But they're always very conservative. And one thing you might want to do, if you're doing the equivalent, we have two checks, the nuclear check, high strength bolting check, and also the equivalent pressure check. If you're doing the equivalent pressure check, you'll get the data from B16.5 or something like that, bring in that data directly. Okay. The thing is, they're almost always overloaded. But one thing that is generally assumed is that you're going to eventually test that flange connection. The leak test is going to be at 1.5 times design pressure. So if that flange pair is supposed to survive that leak test, then why don't we design it for 1.5? Why don't we apply a maximum load of 1.5 times the pressure? So I won't just use the API, excuse me, the B16.5 limits, but I'll bump them up by 50%. How do I make the program do that? Well, the program has the data from, let's say, B16.5 in a file called asme-2009.flg. It's in the system folder. I simply took that file and changed a multiplier in here. There's a conversion factor for other units, but the third value, there's a temperature scale, temperature offset, and pressure. So this is going from Fahrenheit to centigrade. But the third one, if I put in 2/3, that's going to increase the pressure by 50%. We divide by that 2/3. Okay? And that's the only change I had to make to that file. I gave it a different name, 1.5 ASME. And then I automatically get that extra 50% boost on my allowable pressure line. If your company does that kind of stuff, you don't have to do much work to get that up to Caesar 2. So when you start up that processor, there I say, yes, I want a flange check, it's an equivalent pressure check. I click this button to populate this data down here, and there's my new file that I built, and I place it, so it's now another candidate being selected. I put that in there, and now when I use that file, instead of, let's say I'm running at 400 Fahrenheit, I get 200 PSI. Here I get 400, I get 300 PSI. Easy way to get that extra bump in your allowable pressure. Here's a rather new feature in the program. I think it came out in the last release. If you hover over the pipe, it'll fly out your data on that element. Nice way to see what the node numbers are if there's no node numbers listed on the fly. But now, if you do a right click on that same pipe, you'll get a menu up here, and you have three choices: element, restraint, and rigids. What do they do? Well, an element will allow you to insert an element, or break an element, or delete it. Okay. So if you want to drop another node in really quick, just click it there. You don't have to find that button on the toolbar to say break. Just click on the pipe and say break. You can add a restraint on the system. Now adding a restraint, you will basically mimic a restraint from somewhere else, so you can't just generate a new one on your own there. But if there's an existing one, you could duplicate it at the new point in the system with a break.
we can insert on its own, and also you can convert an element into a rigid element if you wanted to. So these are just, you know, go to that pipe and do a right click on it, see what happens. This feature has been in the program for a while. You might have seen this toolbar. This is our move edit geometry toolbar, and it's kind of like the stretch command in CAD. You click on a bunch of nodes and you just pull them away from the rest of them. And it's kind of an awkward button. You click on the first button and it will automatically highlight the second one as well. And it's up to you to use the second one, third one, or fourth one. Well, what do they do? Well, this means move it only in X, move it only in Y, move it only in Z, okay? But you could also do all three directions. So let's take a look at that quick. I'll use a different model for that. I just got a loop sitting here, and I want to extend the loop. It's there, hovering over that. It's 4 feet. I want to make it 6 feet. To make it easier on me, I'm going to look down from the top. And first of all, I'll click on that button, that tiny button here, this one. There's move geometry. And it wants, if I use it like this, it wants to move in the X direction. Well, I want to move it in the Z direction. Now, I see these little dots here. You control the size and the color of that dot. A lot of times it's too big or too small. But here we are, I changed this already. Now I draw a box around what I want to move. So I'm first going to say, yes, I want to move in Z. Draw the box around these two. Let my mouse go. Then I click on one of them, and I start moving it in the negative Z direction. So you see, right there I just added 83 inches to that length. Well, I'm just going to type it in by hand. I'll just type in, my mouse wants to move it around. I'll just type in minus 24. And the loop grew 24 inches. You move those two nodes 24 inches around. Now I can also change the orientation. I'm just going to select them again. And now I'm going to, instead of just doing one number, I'm going to say, now 6 foot, I'm going to make it stand up. So I want to move it in the Y direction. Well, I want to move it 0 in the X. In the Y direction, I'm going to go 72 positive. And in the Z direction, I want to go positive 72. Now it stands up that loop. So it's a very easy way to throw loops around. So if you're dropping in a loop on a system, you know, that thrust line approach, if you go in one direction, you might get the same load, but the moment's too high. You throw it the other direction, now the moment's different. Okay, so you can control these loads by fooling around with these loops. Another rather new command in the program, find replace on list. A lot of people are expecting these lists to work like Excel. They are not, but they're getting closer to it. Okay, we're finding more and more places where we can drop in data directly in these reports. Well, if I go in here, I'm in the restraint list. We have this find replace, and I can then find and replace terms in bulk. We had a model last week. Guy was running. Oh. Kind of interesting. What was it? Buried pipe using the CSER2 soil modeler, and he changed units. His units were initially newtons per millimeter. He changed them to kilonewtons per millimeter, and he got different numbers in the output, and he didn't know why. Well, I didn't know why either. It turns out that the program, when you use this the soil model, it has a bilinear stiffness. It's K1, the model with soil stiffness, it goes to K2. Go plastic, so it's basically, you know, elastic, perfect, and plastic. We don't go perfectly, we say a stiffness of 1, that's pretty darn flexible. Well, it's 1 newton per millimeter, or 1 kilonewton per millimeter in these two models. And that was the source of his issue. But I still had to compare these two models for him. I had to give him what I did is took the millimeter, newton per millimeter file, and I had to change all the ones to 100s or 1000s to match the other data. This is a giant model, and I don't know how many times you do this. You just play an accountant, change a number. You do that for like 20 minutes, just changing these numbers. Well, it went a little bit faster with this processor, and I'm not going to take up, you know, all your time for doing this one. But in this model here, I'll go to my list, I'll say edit, list, elements. Well, no, not that, I'm going to list restraints. I'll use this button down here. Show me my restraint list. So here's my, such a high resolution screen I can't grab. Okay, now here's, I've got two guys with gaps that I put a quarter inch gap on. Somebody tell, oh, they're half inch. Now, I'm not going to quibble about that number, but if I want to change them both at one time, find replace, I click in that column in the data area, and I'll say find 0.25 and change it to 0.50 and replace all. There, okay, so now, you know, if you got some coefficient of friction you want to change, there's other ways to handle it, but any field in here, if you have plus y's, you can turn them to y's, and you can do them one at a time, so you can just skip over the ones you don't want to change, but just say change or don't change, okay? We're going fast, aren't we? I'm great already. Okay. Frankly, I really don't like this. The element list is huge. Every value on your input screen is in this one list, okay? And okay, I'm looking at the good stuff over here from 10 to 15. It's in, you know, so long in the x direction, it's in pipe size. The next thing I want to see is all the way over here, temperature 1. How the heck do, you know, I want to skip all this stuff. Well, you can just click on all these titles and drag them to small width, and then it'll zip them close to one another. Do that quick. I'll put it down here again. Elements. Yeah, look at all this stuff. I want to get. There's my OD wall thickness. This is the next thing I'm interested in. So what I'll do is I'll just do this. And I'll just shrink it out. Like that. And they're all shrunken together. They all, so now I've got my temperature right by the wall. And you know, when you come in the next time, they'll go back. So you don't have to worry about trying to pull them open again. So that might be one way that you can organize the screen. I would imagine that there will be a day when you can change the order on your own. And then you don't have to fool around with this. But in the meantime, this is how you can do it. Talking about these lists, they can get all over the place. And in fact, I run into people who just click. I'm clicking, there's a little drop arrow right by that big piece of paper. If you click on the paper itself, you get all the lists. And oh my word, they're all over the place. What am I gonna do? Well, I'm just gonna click on the thing again and say close them all. And just pick one that I want. And it'll be the elements list. I use that quite often. Now, it's floating out on its own. If I let it touch, see the top edge is about ready to touch the top up there. And now they're stacked. But if you take it just a little bit farther, I'll put it back where it was, and I want my arrow over the title bar here. If it's on the title bar, you're gonna see the shadow will, I don't see where that screen is. Well, let's do it again. Now they're tacked. There's my piping input, there's my elements. Piping elements. And I usually do that with the, and my machine sits like this almost all the time. I can stack all three of them together. So the next time I come to this model, there's my input, there's my element list, there's so they're organized. It's just keeping them together. Okay. Nice way to handle that data. Reset view. Not so much a tip here, but when you open up a brand new job, this button is always highlighted. In other words, when you put another piece of pipe that goes off the screen, it'll reduce everything so you can see everything on your screen. You want to do that when you're building a model because you're going off in way off the screen. When you come back the second time, it's going to be set like this. So it will not follow you around, okay?
Now, if you're building a model, let's say you build your line, you come back to a little control station or something like that, a bypass roundabout, you want to just stay on that focus. You don't want to go back to the whole model. So even if you're on the initial input, turn that thing off, and then the program won't mess around with your plot view. The camera will stay put right there. So it's going to be easier to, you won't have to keep on zooming in and trying to get back to your point. So again, when you want to stay tight in a close area, turn it off. But remember that when you leave the model and come back, it'll automatically be turned off. So let's say you're still building your input after lunch or something like that, close it before you went to come back, it'll automatically be like this. So you might want to turn it on in that case. All right, now we're in the analysis section here. Static load case editor. We have friction in the program, of course, but there's always a question of what's friction actually doing in my analysis? What effect this has on my model? So if I have that worry, I want to run it. I'm kind of a relativist in this. I run it both ways and see how the numbers change. If they don't change, who cares? If they do change, I want to spend more time looking at the reason for it or to qualifying that change. You don't have to run a second model. What you can do is in the load case editor, you can repeat the load case again. Here's weight, temperature, pressure, hanger sizing, of hanger load. Here's another one. But I gave it a different title. It says operating case, no friction. Now that didn't do anything. Okay, that's just the title. But over here, under friction multiplier, I changed the friction multiplier to zero. So that's zero times the mu. Okay? So here I'm turning it off completely. So that's full friction, no friction. If the numbers don't change, it's not a big deal. If they do change, then I want to look at it some more. If I wanted to change it from 0.3 to 0.2, I put a 0.67 in here, and I get 0.2 rather than 0.3. Use some of these fields. These are way out the end of that thing. Take a look at them every once in a while. Load case template. If you look at the output from Caesar 2, the load case that we build up in Caesar 2, the program recommends load cases for calculating expansion stress range and sustained stresses. That's a typical approach for most process piping and power piping. Some of the other piping goes in different ways of doing it. But we have four different flavors of the load cases that are recommended. Okay, you set them in your configuration file. The database definitions, load case template. We ship four of them with the software. Well, the one that we go to now, the default, will include all the stress ranges between all the operating cases. If you've been using Caesar 2 for a very long time, you know, we always went from installed to operating 1, installed to operating 2, and installed to operating 3, and that was it for the expansion stress ranges. Now, the program defaults to, well, it does those, but it also does operating case 1, operating case 2, operating case 2 to operating case 3, 3 to 1. All of a sudden, you got this really long list of load cases. If that's tiring, you don't have to use that. You can pick a different report here. In addition to that, it also does the alternate sustain case. That's a rather new load case in Caesar 2. It's rather analytical in that we would run the operating case, find out what supports are active or inactive, and just use that same support configuration with the weight plus pressure case, or whatever your sustain case is. And that would then be another candidate to adjust the allowable stress for the expansion stress range. There's another phrase in the P31.3 allowable stress criteria for expansion stress range that says that's what you should do, or something like that. That's a new default, but that's a lot of load cases. With other flavors, if you're not running 31.3, you could have that done as well. I'm not too interested in that. This is the one that would be the simplest one, the basic combination. Again, that goes from installed operating 1, installed operating 2, and so on. It doesn't do all those other combinations. And it doesn't have the alternate sustain case. Okay? So if you're not referencing 31.3, you might want to go to load.tpl instead. Well, no, that's a misstatement there. That'd be load basic instead. If you're not referencing 31.3, load basic. It's an error in that. Also, we're seeing people running more and more load cases. I remember, 5 years ago, we went from 100 load cases to 1,000 or 999, something like that. And I think people are still not happy. Some of these PIPSO systems, I've seen some company templates where they have easily 100 load cases and they do a lot of things. Won't get into all that, but do they type all that in? Well, I hope not, because you have the ability now in the load case editor to import load cases from other models. So you have somebody build the model completely or the load cases completely, then just steal those load cases. Well, steal might not be the right word. We'll do that here with this one. I'll get this to the load case editor. And in fact, in our seminars here in Houston, we do this to save some time during the class because there's a lot of stuff we want to do. So just push this button, you get all these load cases. Here's this load case, I just a weight load in it, nothing else. But I can say import load cases, and it works. So you better have the same units and the same loads and everything. And I'll go out to my data set, load cases. And we have an analysis that does seismic work on, open that up, and here I have all these load cases. I didn't have to type all that stuff in. Now I can't use that here because I don't have them available, but U1 is the static load, G load in X, U2 is load in Y, U3 is load in Z, D1 is displacements, seismic displacements in X, D3 is seismic displacements in Z. So these load cases handle operating case and all these different seismic operating cases. And then these at the bottom, these are the combinations where this will give me my minimum displacements and forces. This will be my maximum displacement forces and stresses by pulling numbers out of all these different sets. And I didn't have to type it in. Here's another one, also in the same folder. This is for a fatigue analysis where we actually do fatigue calcs, where we specify number of cycles and everything. So here, again, there's a lot of complexity here that somebody had to get right once, and then everybody else could copy it. Okay. Verify it, though, first. Okay, we've had this request a couple times, and Rich, I don't know why he doesn't put it in, but you run a wind load on your piping system, okay? ASE7 2005 or something like that, and there's your output. But you didn't get to see the pressure profile. Okay, you don't know what pressures the program's applying. Well, you can build a model to do that, okay? So I built a model that I want to match. This is Rich's hand calcs for, or Excel spreadsheet, for our seminar model that has wind load on it. He went by hand and found the elevation of each element, the center of every one of these pieces, this is a riser offshore. This one's 2.5 feet off zero elevation, 7.5, and so on. And he calculates this QZ. That's the codes, ASE7's pressure, wind pressure on the pipe, okay? So how can I verify that is what the program's using. Now what he did in his example, he went and calculated by hand what the load in each pipe would be, and then he could compare those numbers. But I wanted to do it on my own. So what did I do?